Thank you for coming, and thank you also to BASF for the opportunity to speak to you this afternoon. This is going to have a little bit of science and technology in it, but first of all, I just want to show you two works of art. In 1850, you know, isn't that a difference from what we're seeing downstairs today? But there are people who might think that actually the local production of fruit and vegetables and the local sale of fruit and vegetables on the market in the place where it was produced might actually be the future as well as the past. There's another aspect of the past as well, and we mustn't forget another work of art which some of you may have seen in Dublin, notifying us really that actually hunger is still with us. And of course, at the same time, that wonderful painting that I just showed you was painted was, of course, terrible famine throughout Europe, created to a degree by a disease of the potato crop, which is indeed still with us, even 160 years on. Well, I don't need to tell this audience that the global food system is extremely complicated. I don't intend to go through that diagram, but let me show you that's not just the production and the market chain, it's actually all the politics and it's all of the resources which go into it. It's a complicated business. Now, as Christina referred to, I spent 2 years working with a group looking at the future of food and farming, including the sort of things that we've been talking about in round the corridors this morning and this afternoon. And our chief scientist in the UK came forward with this notion of a perfect storm because of the increasing demand for energy, the increasing demand for food, of course, with population increase, and the increasing demand for water, all set against the background of climate change and the challenge that that provides in terms of food security. And now, probably for the first time in 20 years, food is right at the centre of many things, global politics and trade, the environment, the issues of energy, the emerging technologies of genetic manipulation, genomics, human health and the concerns that people have in terms of how food affects their health. All of this is really demanding of a research and knowledge transfer and innovation framework. So really, what you might say, tomorrow's issues are really becoming today's issues. This is a graph from Foresight which is extremely instructive. Although we think we've got volatility in today's markets, and you can see at the end of this graph the volatility from sort of 2007 onwards, prior to 1980, 81, 82, 83, there was huge volatility in global markets. But for 20 years, you can see that really the world has been awash with food. The supply has exceeded the demand. It's been very hard for farmers to make a living, and indeed many governments thought that the job was done. There was complacency amongst governments because essentially they thought that really there was no need to invest. So there was a lot of disinvestment in technical skills, research capacity and extension. The exceptions to that were in Brazil and China and other parts, a few other parts of the world. There was a change in focus, a lot of impact, a lot of focus on the environment and the environmental impact of agricultural and horticultural production systems. A lot of concern about the socioeconomic issues, fair trade, quite right. As well as, of course, an investment in basic science as distinct from the application of science. We've now entered a different world, and we have to use that investment of 20 years ago when food was, you might say, plentiful, to think about the future when, in actual fact, there is going to be a greater demand on the supply side than the supply side can probably meet. And probably the days of cheap food may be over. Perhaps forever. And you can see, although there is volatility in the system, you can see the ever-increasing price of food. Now, this is against a background where essentially we need to maintain these sustainable supply chains. That's going to require foresight and innovation, as Christina referred to. We have to draw on science and technology for that. There are many factors, but I'm going to emphasize in this talk four. I'm going to talk about people, population and the prosperity, and that's the demand side. I'm going to talk about climate change and weather patterns, because that's also really important that we actually understand and we can predict what the future is going to bring us in that direction. I'm going to talk about land use and land management. That's all about sustainability. Where are we going to be able to produce? What are we going to be able to produce? How are we going to be producing it? And I'm going to talk particularly about pest, diseases and weeds, which really, really badly influence the supply and quality. And that, again, is all about the science-based products and practices and the tools and the technologies that we will need to have to be able to produce the quality of product and the quantity of product that we're going to need. So something about people and populations. We know the population of the world is going to reach at least 9.5 or 10 billion. The graph at the top here is really indicative of the fact that most of that growth is going to be in Asia and in Africa. So that's where the global markets are going to be in the future. And it's going to be urban, because now for the first time a couple of years ago, more people are living in cities than are living in rural areas. When people live in cities, they're very vulnerable to food price increases. You can't go and hunt for famine food in the countryside. And of course, people in cities can organise, and you can end up with civil unrest. So it's really important that actually we make sure that the future doesn't lead us in that direction. We must be mindful of the stable markets, the fact that population will not increase much in many parts of the world, but will increase hugely in Africa and Asia. This is a complicated slide, but what it's really saying is it's sometimes quite hard to work out from the figures how many people in the world really are short of food. Some very recent work's been done on this particular topic, and I think it's now clear that probably it's around about 850 million people who actually don't have enough calories in their diet. But the bottom graphs, the orange, green and red graph, the red graph is essentially saying these are the people essentially that have enough calories almost to have a static way of life, not to have to be able to do a full day's work in the way that you and I can do. And it's the orange graph which actually illustrates the number of people who actually really are undernourished. And by undernourished, it means the sorts of nutrients that are provided by fruit and vegetables, not just the calories. And in the green graph at the top, you can see that actually the per capita availability, not consumption, but availability of fruit and vegetables is increasing, but it is still inadequate in order to meet people's daily requirements for the nutrients that those products produce. Now, I'm going to talk about land. If we didn't use land productively, and here's a classic example of large-scale arable agriculture in Brazil, we wouldn't actually have this, in other words, the Amazon. So although that sounds a bit perverse, the truth is that we need to intensify our agriculture on the smallest footprint of land in order to be able to conserve the green, the rainforests, the natural world, which of course is not just important for biodiversity and conservation, but is hugely important for the capture of carbon and essentially the mitigation of climate change, which I shall talk about in a moment. And the truth is, we've probably reached peak land. There is no more land unless we start to destroy more of the natural environment. And you can see what that graph at the top says is that if we had not been increasing our intensity and productivity from land, the amount of land that we would have needed to actually feed the population. So essentially, we are producing the food that the world needs predominantly on about 35% of the land requirement if we'd just been doing what we were doing in the 1960s. That's a huge achievement. And of course, it's important that we actually continue to do that. So land sparing is a really important component of sustainability, not ploughing any more land than we need. And much of the land, of course, globally has been degraded over the years. And these pie charts indicate in different parts of the world the sorts of areas which now we really need to regenerate, because they are still potentially productive areas, but they've just been mistreated over the years. And so we have a job to do to ensure that we reverse the soil degradation. This is a very interesting graph, and it relates to 174 crops. including many of the crops that we've seen downstairs. And what this actually tells you is whether or not we've increased the production of these crops by increasing the land area, or whether we've been increasing the yield and the quality. If you go up vertically, up the line, that means that we've, to the end, to this side of the of this dotted line, we have more production. But sometimes we've made more production because we've increased the yield on the same area. Sometimes, going over here, we've actually increased the production simply by ploughing more land. The size of the spot is the area of the total crop. So really, where we need to be in the future is we need to be up in that corner, and we don't need to be going over in that direction. So that is a demand for yield and quality produced not by producing more on more land, but by producing more on less land, or at least the same area of land. So sustainable intensification is really all about raising productivity, increasing the resource use efficiency, and reducing the negative impacts on the environment. It's an integrating concept, and it meets many of the challenges. It's all about the outcomes. It's not about the means of doing it. It's all about getting good data. It's not about having dogmatic positions about whether it's organic or whether it's GM. It's an inclusive concept, and it's a both and. It's not an either or. And so really, my hypothesis is that if we produce as efficiently as possible on the smallest footprint of land, then that is the greenest way, and it probably produces the most profit as well. Thank you. You realise I was dry enough. Okay, so sustainable intensification, these are the components. Increase the genetic potential. We've seen some superb examples of genetic innovation in terms of varietal quality out there today. But realising that genetic potential in the growing systems that we adopt, reducing the waste, both pre-harvest and post-harvest, so more of that product gets to market to meet the demand, and reducing the environmental impact. That's the package that we have to deliver. Now, bad weather, which we've all experienced, of course, is often underestimated by climate change models. But it's clear that the frequency of extreme weather events is increasing. I'll show you some data for that in a moment. But, for example, the climate change models nevertheless predict increasing droughts in China over the next 15 years. That could have huge impact on global markets. So these data are from simulations, but they demonstrate what would happen if the variability, not just the mean temperature, but the variance of that, that weather changed. And you can see the difference between the number of days over here, you know, where you've got a very, very extreme temperatures, if the variance changes as well as the mean. And this is last year. You know, the big blue spots, including Northern Europe, were where weather was clearly much colder and much more rainfall, you know, a really bad year in Northern Europe from the point of view of cold and wet. But look at the Midwest of the United States, drought and large temperature increases. And you can look and see that this is not a uniform pattern. So think about supply chains and think about where the predictability is going to be in terms of where product is going to be coming from with the unpredictability of weather events. Now, this is, I think, a very instructive slide. What this is telling us is that if you look at natural disasters, things like volcanoes, earthquakes, over a long period of time, this is from the insurance industry, so this is people who really have to pay the cost of this. There's been almost no change, that's the red bar at the bottom, no change in the frequency with which these disturbances have taken place. All of the rest is weather-related, meteorological events, flooding, and extreme temperatures and fire. So you can see that there is a clear trend in terms of the extreme events that we're going to have to cope with as we look into the future. And it's not just weather. So these are data from a paper, again, very recent paper, talking about disease, both animal disease and plant disease. We're interested in plant disease. This demonstrates the green line here. the number, increasing number of what are referred to as emerging infectious diseases. These are either diseases which have increased in severity, or they've moved from one place to another, or they've changed in terms of their virulence, and they can attack plants or varieties which weren't the case previously. That's another thing we have to contend with, and that's really where I want to go now. If you just take a single crop, just think of all the apples that we've seen out there today. Huge number of apples. But just think about what the apple farmer is contending with. These are just a range of the diseases. That's just one crop. One crop, many problems to manage. Think about all the crops that we've got out there and think about the multiplication of that issue. So here's the challenge. We've got increasing demand, we want high quality and quantity because of population and prosperity. We've got resource constraints, particularly land, and we've got increasing pest and disease risk because of climate, trade issues, of course, moving things around. And the challenge is that can probably only be met by significantly increased investment in science and innovation. If we do nothing, it gets worse. And that's really a question of using every single tool in the box. We've got to get ahead of the game in terms of prediction and anticipation. I'll show you some of that in a moment. We've got to have good diagnostic systems, DNA-based diagnostic systems, so we know what we're dealing with, what the variation is. We need lots of innovation in agronomy. I shan't talk about that. But we need to exploit crop genetics and genomics. Pest and disease resistance is clearly a hugely important thing looking into the future, including biotechnology. Precision approaches in engineering. Novel chemistry will be important. I have to say that. BASF is my sponsor for this talk. But it's true. We need novel chemistry. And we also need to include biocontrol and exploit the whole power of microbial metagenomics for providing biocontrol agents. This is just to give a bit of an indication from some work that's going on in the UK under a project called SEPTA. And it's just demonstrates what is going to happen in terms of the problems for a range of diseases on a range of vegetable fruit crops there, you can see, because of the reduction in the availability of fungicides as a consequence of regulation in Europe. These are serious issues that we're going to have to contend with. What about prediction? Can we get better at it? I think we can. This is a scheme, and I just show you an example of it, where we can simulate weather data in the future using the climate change predictions on a very site-specific basis. This is work that's been done by an ex-colleague of mine at Rothamsted. We can plug that simulated weather data, in this case for the UK, but it could be anywhere in the world, into models of crop development and disease development, and we can produce predictions of the severity and the incidence of disease. This is just an example of a brassica disease in Britain, thinking about the situation up until 1990 and what we would expect to be the case in terms of severity in 2050. So that gives us an opportunity to say, well, this is, if we want to carry on growing these crops, then we have to do something about being able to protect these crops from this disease, which is going to become much more severe. A few demonstrations from my own work, actually, and that of close colleagues, to show that actually we've got huge power at our hands if we actually exploit genetics in the genetic variability of the different species. And here you can just see clubroot disease in brassica, verticillium wilt in strawberry, that's carrot fly in carrots, and that's a root aphid disease in lettuce. But this is you see this all over, but we're not exploiting the power of genetics to help us control diseases. So in my last message really is that there needs to be a partnership between the laboratory and the field. That will provide, you might say, the key to the future. And I think we have got to be embracing of technology. Technology will be, you might say, the future. But of course, we still want to see those beautiful high value and high quality products, which the consumer, of course, will want. So really, my finishing line is, let's keep the shelves full. But if we're going to keep the shelves full, then actually we're going to need the science and innovation to do it. Thank you.
BASF, the chemical company.